Amen. Praise God this morning for such wonderful music to get our hearts and minds focused on the reason that we're here. And at this time, we're going to do something a little different. We're going to ask you to follow along with the lyrics on the screen, if I can have them click down a couple to "More Like Thee." And every time we get to the chorus as we sing this song, we're going to ask you to sing with us. You don't have to stand or anything, as we get to the chorus each time, we'll ask you to sing with us.
Can everybody hear me? Am I good? Am I on?
Nope.
Am I thingy on here? Yeah, I'm on here. Hey, Eric. Okay, they. Welcome to Codorus, and a great song to start with. I like that concept, "More and More Like Thee." If you remember last week, we spent some time at 1 Corinthians 13, and part of that message is about our journey we were on to completion. We're not complete right now. We won't be until the day we get to heaven, but it is a journey, and each day, hopefully, we grow a little bit more, a little bit closer to Christ. So, a good way to start our service this morning. A few announcements before I do. As I look at my front pew over here where Pam is sitting, I see a lot of musical instruments. And I know there's a lot of kids in the sanctuary who would like to play those instruments. So, our next song, "Love Come Down," we have an opportunity for all of you all before you go to the Glow Children's Church to play those instruments. So while I'm going through announcements, you guys can start coming forward and picking out the instrument you want. Just a few announcements to pass along here while that's happening. You have seen us announced several times the Ladies' Night Out on October 23rd. And the plan is to meet here at the church at 5 o'clock. But we know that that's kind of a tricky time of day, some people getting off work and things like that. So if anybody cannot make it to the church by 5 o'clock but still would like to go, you can certainly still do that. Please contact Charlene Seymour, and she will help you make arrangements to make sure you can go. So don't let the 5 o'clock time frame be the reason you don't come to that. So just reach out to her. Another thing going on here tomorrow will be the women's Bible study. Well, two things tomorrow. We'll have story hour So if you have any little ones that would like to come and listen to the story, that'll be at 10 o'clock tomorrow here at the church. And then tomorrow evening for the ladies, we will have our women's Bible study at 6:30. And then on Saturday, we have a couple things. At 8 in the morning, we have men's group. And then at 4 o'clock next Saturday will be a game night. So certainly plan on coming to those things. The sandwich sale, we're coming down to the last week. So please, if you would like some sandwiches, sign up on the narthex out there. That's going to benefit Back Ministry. We talked about ladies' night out. Oh, next week, soup and salad after church. I know that's something everybody looks forward to. So that is starting back up next week. So please plan to come for that. If you have newsletter or council articles, that goes in this week. And then one other announcement is out on the middle table, you'll see a little bin. We are looking at naming the ball field. And so we're looking for suggestions. We've seen some interesting ones, some good ones, but we're hoping to narrow those down and vote for that at council next month. So please put any suggestions you have in there. November 16th is our Family Fun Fest, our Harvest Fest. That was going to be earlier, but we moved that to the 16th. And there's some sign-up sheets if you'd like to help or bring any pies. And that's it for announcements. Again, look through the TV screen and your bulletin for any other things. So at this point, we are going to have our song.
The kids can come up and stand right here next to me. They're anxiously ready to start pounding those instruments. So please stand right here next to me, and we're going to start our song, and you're just going to do what I do. Can you handle that like a Simon Says? Okay. All right. So you're just going to help me keep the beat. Here we go. And the rest, please stand out in the congregation. Choir, you can relax. Congregation, please stand and join us singing Love Come Down. Here we go. I once was blind, I could not see. Chains of sin had shackled me, but God in heaven heard my plea. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. Think the adults can help us clap? Yeah, let's go. They can help us, right? Here we go. Now grace so sweet, it floods my soul, and hope eternal won't let go. My debt erased at Calvary, Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. Forever of your love come down. With my hands toward heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. Good job. Let's praise God with it, right? You're doing great. There's a home. There's a home beyond the sky. A song we'll sing all of time. The grave is empty, I am free. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. Are you ready? Sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. Sing forever, love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. Sing forever of your love come down. Sing forever of your love come down. God. Have a seat. All right, go to Glow.
I love that. So at this time, we're going to have our praises and our concerns. If you have any praises or concerns to add to what's in your bulletin, please go back to the microphone there.
I have an update on my brother-in-law. So I had the dates wrong. He starts chemo tomorrow.
Chemo's tomorrow, okay.
Yep, first day is tomorrow and 5 hours, 5 days a week. So
5 hours, 5 days a week?
Yep.
For how long?
So one round is Monday through Friday, 5 hours each day. Then he takes 2 weeks off with a chemo shot those each week. And that's one round. That counts as one round.
Okay.
He has to do that three times.
Three times. Okay.
So thank you, guys.
That starts tomorrow. Sure. Yep. Thank you for the update. And I wanted to just raise a praise while if you're thinking of some others. We had put out, and I forgot to announce, we are collecting money for hurricane relief. The information is there in the bulletin. You just put your money in an envelope marked Hurricane Helene Relief. And at this point, you just put Hurricane Relief because it's going to go to the Brethren Disaster Relief. And, of course, now we have two hurricanes that we're recouping from. So, but you can put that on an envelope. Last week, we collected over $3,000 in just 1 week. So that's incredible. And just continues to show the generosity of this church, which we appreciate. We're at least like to collect for another week. And then if you don't have it today, you want to just give us a call or give Vicki a call. That can go in at any time after this week. But we just want to get that out there for folks. Jerry.
I want to elaborate on the Brethren Disaster Ministries and what they sent out this week in relief for the Hurricane Helene victims. They sent out over $500,000 worth of stuff, whether it was in hygiene buckets, cleanup, school kits, all of that stuff, in addition to some monetary relief. And it's amazing. If you go to the Brethren website, you will see some of that stuff listed. But think about the monies that came into from the churches last week. And they'll be added on to that. It'll be a continual thing. But they do need, they showed the warehouse down at New Windsor. Anybody ever been to the warehouse in New Windsor? And no, okay. It was almost empty because they sent out so many cleanup buckets. We need to replenish that. I don't know if there's somebody here at Codorus that helps to get that going, but if there is someone that could repack some cleanup buckets. They need them.
Thank you, Jerry.
So for sure, this is incredible news that they're getting the help that, you know, and there's a lot of damage down there, so that's going to take a while, but that's a very good step in the right direction. Are there any others that we want to add to that list?
Yes, Eric. I don't know the name, but there was a gentleman yesterday afternoon at the Gladfelter paper mill that got run over in the parking lot by one of the employees. It was no accident, but he did die. I don't know the names, but just for all of those involved and for those employees, I know it really affected my nephew because he worked with the gentleman that died.
All right, thank you for that. We'll pray for that family for sure. And we'll add that under the sympathy column. You see that we put Dave Schweitzer's family on. We prayed for him last week, and he was on hospice, and he went home to be with the Lord. So we continue to raise up that family as well as the family of Gary Kling. His services were yesterday. Are there any others? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the ability to come to you in prayer. We don't always take advantage of that. But Lord, as a church, we can gather because we're reminded in Scripture that where two or three are gathered, there you are in the midst of them. Doesn't mean that we can't pray on our own, but it's certainly a powerful thing to be able to pray as a church community. especially as we look at a list like this of all the needs, a lot of them in our church, a lot of them from outside. And Lord, we can raise these up in the same spirit, knowing that you're going to take care of these things. We especially think of those who are dealing with loss, as we think of Gary Kling's family and Dave Schweitzer's family, and this gentleman who was killed in this accident over at Gladfelter, and many others that we maybe not know the name here, Lord, but you do. The loss of a loved one is among the greatest of human trials, and we certainly lift those people up to experience your comfort and peace in the midst of that loss. We think of also the loss in the form of those recovering from the hurricanes, first Helene and then Milton. And we just pray, Lord, that you would continue to be with the efforts. We thank you for the generosity of those who gave, the amount of money and supplies that are able to go down to help those folks out. Lord, it's certainly appreciated, but there's certainly more to go. So we pray that that generosity would continue. We're also grateful for the community that's being built down there. We're hearing of people that have lost so much, and those are the ones that are helping others. Not worried about their own loss, but they're worried about helping others. And what an incredible show of community and selflessness and love. And Lord, just pray that you would bless those efforts down there. The many people who are taking things down or volunteering in any way, and just a lot of efforts. We just pray that you continue to be with those. We pray for a number of unspokens that I'm aware of this week, of different surgeries or different hospital stays or different things going on that we're not able to mention names, but Lord, you know the need. And that's one of the amazing things about you. Before we even ask, you know the needs of our hearts. And so we lift up those needs, that you would bring healing where healing is needed, for successful surgeries, for comfort and peace where that's needed. Lord, each one of us has a need, and we just lift up each person, that you administer to each one according to those needs. But Lord, not only our needs, not only our requests, but just give us a reminder of the reasons we have to praise you. The number one being just your Son, Jesus Christ, who came, who gave his life on the cross so that we could have everlasting life. And Lord, we thank you so much for the forgiveness that comes with that, and just the love that was demonstrated that we can then pour out to other people. That comes first. The Bible says that we love others because we were first loved by you. And so for that, we're thankful. We thank you for each person here, for each one participating in this service. And as we have our choir singing and our instrumentalists and the folks working in the back and those working with GLOW and all of us here, Lord, we just pray that our combined efforts, that what happens here this morning in our worship time and in our learning time, that it would bring honor and glory to you. That you would open our hearts and minds to receive you and all the messages and lessons you would want us to have. We thank you for each person here, visitor and member and everyone, Lord. May we all be blessed by you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to share a song called The Wonder of Love. And I just thought I'd give you a quick background. This comes from our brothers and sisters in Christ in the Mennonite community. I actually heard it the first time this past year at my best friend Jewel Zook's wedding, and it was a long time coming. And this particular song she had picked with her now husband as an honor to God to thank him for bringing the two of them together. So it has some special meaning, and we're going to share The Wonder of Love.
Thank you.
thank you. And please pray with me. Lord, indeed we marvel at the wonder of your love. And we thank you for that love for each one of us. And Lord, as we have our message this morning, we're reminded that your love is to be a model of how we love others and all the different kinds of relationships we have. Lord, we just pray that you would open our hearts and minds to receive your message. Anoint my lips and heart as I share, and all of our ears and minds to receive what you would have us to receive, removing from our thinking that which isn't necessary, but your words flourishing so that we can apply them to our lives, especially as we think about those relationships, especially those that are a little harder to deal with. So we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be in your word this morning. We thank you for many gifts you give us. In Jesus' name, amen. There we go. I'm going to need that later. So when you're a pastor and you're putting a message together for Sunday morning, there's no telling what kind of challenges you run into sometimes, or how well your thoughts will flow, especially depending on the scripture passage you've been given or that you've been led to preach about. Some scriptures are simpler to preach on than others. Some are very easy. Some are kind of medium. But then there are other scriptures that, quite frankly, I never thought I would ever preach from, or even more frankly, that I never necessarily wanted to preach from. But then God says, yeah, well, I got a different idea for you. And so when I come across a passage like Proverbs 25:24, where it says, better to live on the corner of a roof than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife, there are a couple things that come to mind. First of all, how in the world am I going to preach that one? And number two, what is going on that not one, but two people submitted that as a life or inspirational verse? Now, I can get a little jovial about it because I happen to know who did it. I had a confession from that person. They did it just to yank my chain. I won't mention names to protect the guilty. But the funny part was he was confessing it while on the phone with his wife, with me, and they were both laughing. So I assume, you got to be careful with assumptions, that all is well. But then a third thought came to my mind, with all joking aside, which is this. How many people, both inside our church and outside our church, will take the words of that scripture, what it's saying, and actually consider that as something that may be a valid option. Maybe not necessarily going on the roof, but getting away from their spouse or from some other relationship that they're in because of the tumultuous nature of that relationship. And this is a gender-neutral message. The passage talks about a quarrelsome wife, but that can go both ways. I give plenty of examples of relationships on both sides. Both genders can be the ones making it difficult for the other. So I'm actually very glad, after a lot of prayer and a lot of dealing with it, I'm very glad that this verse came up, challenging as it may be, because I believe this is a challenge I needed to accept. Now, a couple disclaimers here. First of all, I know that not everyone in this room is married, and that's okay, because I'm not focusing only on that. There are several types of relationships we're going to discuss from a larger chunk of that passage this morning, and so there's something here for everyone. And the other one is that I am not claiming that by the end of this message that I will have all the answers that you need to fix every relationship you're in. If it were that easy, someone smarter than me would have figured that out a long time ago. We would have all been able to embrace those solutions, and we wouldn't need to talk about this. But the fact is, it's not that easy, because we know that in dealing with relationships, there is always a factor that is beyond our control. And that factor is the other person. And so my goal is to give us another way to think through those relationships. And perhaps another, if nothing else, to give us another point of view, another point of prayer, and a way to take those relationships and figure out how we can look at them through God's eyes. And so what I decided to do was to push this Proverbs 25:24 passage back into the context of the seven verses before it, where Solomon talks about a total of five different groups of people with whom we can relate in some way. Maybe personally, maybe from a distance, but their decisions affect us. Maybe on a once-in-a-while basis, but that once-in-a-while, how we handle that is extremely significant. And we're going to talk about how we can view these different relationships the way God would want us to, despite what may be going on and how difficult it may be. Do you ever have somebody come up to you and say, hey, I have some good news for you and I have some bad news for you? And then somehow the bad news, you may dread hearing the bad news, but somehow psychologically knowing that there's some good news kind of softens the blow of that or softens the fear of that. If you're like me, I always pick the bad news first, save the best for last, so that the good can soften the bad instead of the bad ruining the good. Well, that's what I'm going to do this morning in a little bit different approach from what we normally do. So I'm going to read these eight verses in Proverbs, and I, as always, encourage you to turn to your Bible, Proverbs 25. We're going to read from 17 to 24. And as I'm reading and as you're following along, I want you to see if you can guess the five different groups of people Solomon's talking about. I'm going to give you the answers, but have some fun with it. See if you can guess. Some of them are easier than others. And then very briefly for each, I'm going to give you the bad news, which we probably already know. We already know what some of the bad things can happen in those relationships. But I'm also going to give you the good. What good things could possibly come out of a relationship like that? And we know that's possible because the Bible says in Romans 8 that God works together all things for good. Basically, he can turn the worst situations into good for those who follow him. But it's up to us to trust him to do that. So here's the passage. Follow along if you're able, and then we'll get into it here. Starting at verse 17. And you'll notice some very interesting verses in here, all of them. Seldom set your foot in your neighbor's house. Too much of you, and they will hate you. Like a club or a sword or a sharp arrow is one who gives false testimony against a neighbor. Like a broken tooth or a lame foot is reliance on the unfaithful in times of trouble. Like one who takes away a garment on a cold day, or like vinegar poured on a wound, is one who sings songs to a heavy heart. If your enemy is hungry, give him food to eat. If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head, and the Lord will reward you. Like a north wind that brings unexpected rain is a sly tongue which provokes a horrified look. Better to live on a corner of the roof than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife. So we'll see if you got the five. The very first one was a little more obvious. It kind of came at point blank. In verses 17 to 18, the first thing you hear Solomon talk about is how we can relate to our neighbors. And this is an interesting one. We never really think of this before. You don't usually talk about it in church on Sunday morning. But Solomon quite literally says in verse 17 to be wary about how much you are going to your neighbor's house. And you can apply that in a couple different settings. Because believe it or not, there is such thing as too much of you, or too much of me, or too much of them. And you almost never hear people talk like that in Christian circles, because if you do, people are like, how could you say something like that? That sounds so rude. But then deep inside, you know exactly what we're talking about. Solomon is not saying, do not welcome your neighbor. And he's not saying for you not to come around. What he is saying is know your boundaries and respect the boundaries of others. And when those boundaries are presented, don't misinterpret that as you are not wanted, you are not welcome. The fact is, people are busy today. Nobody who is that busy likes that that's the fact, but we are busy today. People are busy. People are limited on time with their family. So your neighbors, whoever they may be, maybe coworkers, maybe neighbors, anybody, don't need to see 3 hours of you or 3 hours of me, and we don't need to see 3 hours of them every single day. Moderation is a thing, and it's healthy. Relationships can quickly become tarnished if they're pushed too hard. And people don't have the heart to say, look, I really like you, but it's just too much. And so they get all awkward and funny and avoid people and they gossip. And it just gets worse later on. And it's kind of funny that this came up while I'm in the middle of watching one of my favorite TV series way back from the 90s, Family Matters. If you're not sure what that is, that's the one with Steve Urkel. Steve Urkel's the one, the nerdy, annoying neighbor who would just barge into the Winslow house about 250 times a day without knocking. Now, first of all, who keeps their doors unlocked all day, every day in the middle of Chicago? And how do they not learn to lock them after the first 100 Urkel invasions? We have no idea. But he would always do this at the worst time. Maybe Carl, the father, was sick and wanted to be left alone. Or maybe Carl and Harriet, his wife, were trying to have a romantic few moments. How awkward is that when the neighbor comes in? Maybe the family was very busy with stuff going on, and Steve never got the hint. And so it's no wonder his presence was always met with a lot of scoffing and a lot of rolling of eyes. So that's the bad news. When these boundaries are overstepped, Solomon says two things can happen. Verses 17 and 18. Solomon, he said, seldom set your foot in your neighbor's house, too much of you, and they will hate you. Now, there's a very strong word, but the fact is people can become very awkward or just get frustrated because they can't ever seem to have that time to themselves. Or the second thing, like a club or sword, a sharp arrow is one who gives false testimony against a neighbor. Not in every case, but in a lot of cases, a neighbor who knows too much says too much. And it's not long before a relationship that could be so precious, which would be the good news, can get ugly. And its constant distractions, the lack of boundaries, turn into trying to avoid people, turning into frustration, turning into gossip, and turning into some very hard feelings that didn't need to happen, with a bit of understanding and respect. And so a relationship that could be full of kind words can all of a sudden turn very ugly if we're not careful. Don't be an Urkel, and don't be treating others like they are Urkel. James 3, 9 through 10 says, with the tongue we praise our Father and our Lord, and then with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praising and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. And so your relationship with your neighbor can be wonderful. A lot of great and meaningful moments can be had with your neighbor, but the relationship could also be tarnished when boundaries aren't experienced, time and space aren't honored, and gossip begins. But that's just one relationship. Probably not as often as occurring as some of these other ones that were coming up, like this next one. And this one is perhaps a point of even more contention, especially given the day we're facing, considering where we consider how, number two, we relate to our leaders. That's what verse 19 is talking about. Like a broken tooth or a lame foot is reliance on the unfaithful in a time of trouble. We rely on people to lead us out of a difficult time. And moments of trouble are not the only times we want to be able to rely on good leaders. But it's a big deal when we can't rely on them the way we should be able to. In case you haven't noticed, as we approach these final 3 weeks before the presidential election, tensions are a bit elevated. They usually are, but it seems like it's especially been the case the last couple of elections. But here's what we need to consider. No matter what happens, no matter how much research you've done on the candidates, no matter how much good each candidate has done in the past, no matter how much not so good, no matter how you vote, no matter who gets elected on November 5th, no matter what the outcome is, when the dust settles on November 6th, there are going to be people that are going to be happy with the results. There are going to be people who couldn't be happy either way because they don't like either candidate. And there are going to be people who look at Proverbs 25 and 19 and say, that's our president-elect. I can't trust them for anything. Doesn't matter who gets voted in. That's the three ways people are going to feel. And it's not just presidents. It could be governors. It could be congresspeople. It could be leaders and bosses in the company where you work. Maybe it could even be your pastor. It's a big deal when you aren't sure if you can trust the people in leadership. But short of a drastic move, what happens is you're usually stuck with people in those positions. So you can decide to continue to complain and criticize, or you can drop on your knees and lift those people up in prayer. You say, well, who in the right mind would pray for an evil, corrupt, or incompetent leader? Well, the answer is the Apostle Paul would, led by the influence of Christ. 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 2, I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, and intercession and thanksgiving be made for all people, not just the good ones, all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all goodness and holiness. And we'll see where Jesus says the same thing here in a couple minutes. That's the bad news and the good news with leaders. They aren't always who we want in office, and they aren't always reliable, but the good news is once in a while, there are good ones. And always when they aren't, it's an opportunity to pray for their heart, for their leadership, and our attitude towards them, as we could be the one person that begins to break the chain of negativity that we have seen so much of, because it has to start somewhere. Going to number three, it was a little more maybe hard to pick out, but did you guess what the third relationship was in verse 20? Solomon says, like one who takes away a garment on a cold day, or like vinegar poured on a wound, is one who sings songs to a heavy heart. Here Solomon talks about how we relate and treat those who are struggling in life. What are our attitudes and feelings when we walk up to somebody and realize, hey, this person's struggling? Maybe they're hungry. Maybe they're thirsty. Maybe they don't have a place to live. Or maybe they have a medical condition that is the foundation of all the other struggles that you notice. What is the bad news and the good news in this scenario? Well, you tell me, what do you think it is? See, there are three ways we can treat these kind of people. Number one, we can ignore those people and altogether pretend they're there. We just pretend they're not even there. And I don't think I have to tell you how unfortunate of a decision that is. But if we're fair, it doesn't take away perhaps our discomfort when we see those people. And so there's a second thing we tend to do that maybe seems a little bit better, and it relates to what James says in chapter 2. He says in verse 15, suppose a brother or sister is without clothes or daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, that all sounds nice, but then does nothing about their physical needs, what good does that do? And I would add, what if you just say, I will pray for you, and then walk away? I mean, how many times do we actually remember then to pray for them later on? And so that's the second thing. We could try to say kind words. Paul says it's like singing songs to a heavy heart. We can say all the nice things, but it doesn't really help them all that much if we're not willing to do something. So what's the third option that Hebrews 13:2 inspires us to do? Well, in that verse it says, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels or entertained angels without even knowing it. So how do we show hospitality? Well, how many of us have 1,000,001 different blankets laying around, most of them being taken over by the dog, like ours? Can you spare one? Proverbs is talking about taking away blankets from those people. What if we give one back? Instead of praying for someone, maybe you can pray with someone. Stop right there. Put your hand on their shoulder and say a prayer with that person. I seldom suggest giving money to somebody you see out on the, like in the grocery store parking lot, but what if you drive into the lot, you see somebody there that's hungry? How hard is it to spend maybe an extra $6 or $7 to buy a sandwich, a piece of fruit, and a bottle of water? Maybe if you have a couple extra bucks, you can find a small Bible or an inspirational book or something in the store, and you can give it to them on the way out. Can you help them connect with groups like LifePath? LifePath will be here before long to share what they do. Those are groups that can help them with even more things. If you or I were the one that were hungry or homeless, I don't have to tell you how bad that news would be. So as we think about our empathy, how can we be the good news in that relationship? Number four, everybody's favorite. Solomon talks about how we relate to our enemies. Now, we already know what Jesus says about this, and his opinion is the one that matters the most here. In chapter 5 of Matthew, as part of his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, you have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. And I think that's how we kind of tend to be programmed to be sometimes. It's easy to do. But Jesus says, I tell you, love your enemies. And here it is again, pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. There was a Turkish officer who raided and looted an Armenian home. He killed the aged parents and gave the daughters to the soldiers, keeping the eldest for himself. Sometime later, she escaped and trained as a nurse. As time passed, she found herself nursing in a ward of Turkish officers. And as luck might have it, one night by the light of a lantern, she saw the face of this officer who had taken her. He was so gravely ill that without exceptional nursing, he would die. What would you do in this situation? The days passed and he recovered. One day, the doctor stood by the bed with her and said to him, if it wasn't for her devotion for you or to you, you would be dead. And he looked at her and said, we have met before, haven't we? Yes, she said, we have met before. Well, then why didn't you kill me? He asked. She replied, because I am a follower of him who said, love your enemies. Boy, that could be incredibly difficult. I might could take all day to tell you what the Bible says about it, but I can't take away the pain that has been caused by some of your enemies. And I'm sure you all have stories, and if you think of those stories, it's not hard to think of and discuss the bad news in each of those situations. But how can good come out of that? A good start is reflecting on the words of Paul in Romans 12, starting at verse 17, which will sound very familiar to you if you're still looking at today's passage in Proverbs 25. You look at verses 21 and 22 while I read from Romans 12. Paul says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. That's tough, because sometimes if you've been in the business of revenge, it seems like it would feel so good. But instead, he says, be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone, including our enemies. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you. You're going to hear that verse again. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. And here it is. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Another opportunity for you to break the chain of evil that has been passed down. Can we break that chain and kick good back the other direction? How many people could possibly have their lives changed because of that act of kindness? And so the question is, are you a person of ugly revenge? Or are you a person of holy coals? Yes, those hot coals can be painful at first, but your aim is not to hurt, but to heal. Can your kindness, through the guilt that they may experience, realizing, my goodness, this person who I treated so horribly is treating me so well, can that maybe bring them to a place of change and repentance? I'm not saying it happens every time, but you won't know until you do it. Unfortunately, we do not know the outcome of the story this Turkish soldier, but we know the outcome of every sinner who gives their lives to Christ because of his grace and kindness. Because believe it or not, we were all once enemies of Christ. Every person of faith can testify of a life changed by Christ and for Christ. And if it can happen to us, it can happen for others. And finally, the one we started with, that for some people may even strike a chord harder than the first four. Solomon talks about how we relate to our family. Once again, that verse from 24, better to live on a corner of a roof than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife. First of all, this is not a gender issue, as I've mentioned before. Husbands and wives can both be the knuckleheads in a particular quarrel. But I also believe this is another issue of time and space. I don't believe Solomon intended for people to run away for good. I know that happens sometimes. And that's incredibly painful. It isn't the ideal. At the very least, time and space are a good place to start. How often have we been able to solve quarrels with anyone, spouses included, when the fires are raging and the anger is hot and the tension is high? If you say yes, you've been able to do that, you are a rare exception. Normally, it takes time and space. Perhaps your roof, though I don't recommend it. Back then, roofs were flat, so that was a good option. But finding a place to go where you can cool down and regroup and tackle it again when emotions have calmed down. When we were working at school, we used the words de-escalate. If you're trying to get a kid back onto compliance when they're in the middle of a temper tantrum, you're wasting your time. We got to wait till the ability to apply reason and common sense has returned. But even at that, it is not always easy. I'm sure all of us can share some examples in our family. Some would be humorous, some would not. Some of us can laugh at the image of husbands sitting on the roof because of the humorous nature of their relationship. Others see this as a painful reality. I can remember some of the ugly arguments between my parents growing up, sometimes lasting for days. And so it was always a moment of elation when I would hear the arguments slowly turn into them laughing with each other, because then I knew it was okay. They had their time and space, and even though it took a lot longer than might have been ideal, it finally worked. But unfortunately for them, as time went on, the laughter disappeared. What it was that brought them together and made them able to laugh was gone, and their effort to find it again was lost. And so after raising four kids and getting them into their career, and after 35 years of marriage, it did come to an ugly end. I'm not saying that's how it should be because the pastor's parents did. I'm saying that is the reality for people. And that happened in the year 2011. Now, those of you who have been here a while and are savvy on dates know exactly where I was in 2011, right here. And let me tell you, being a pastor of 31 years, a 31-year-old mature pastor does not make the pain of that any easier. Does not make it immune to seeing your parents suffer like that. There are people in this room who have been through this as an offspring, watching this happen to your parents, or it happened to you as the spouse, and you know the pain of it. So this is not an easy fix. That's not what I'm talking about today. Some people may be struggling with their marriage now. Some may have scars in the past. And while it's impossible to address every situation you face today, and frankly, unfortunately, I wish I could solve all the problems. It's impossible for me to solve all those problems and hurts and struggles. Know that you are not alone. Your pain is not isolated to just to you. You're not the only one dealing with it. There are people around you who can relate and who you can go to and find solace in. That's the bad news of it, but there's good news to family as well. Perhaps you look at your children. Maybe you do have a great testimony of a rocky marriage that was repaired. And maybe you see the good and blessing of the family that you have, maybe the extended family. Even families are not immune to the good and the bad and the ugly. And the fact of the matter is, that's the nature of human relationships. And while not every situation has a clean and happy ending, there is something that we can do. Unfortunately, we can't control other people, so there are situations in which our hands are tied. They're tied by the stubbornness of someone else. And we go back to what it says in Romans 12. The Apostle Paul says, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with others. You can only do what you can do, but you need to make the best of what you're doing. How are you responding to others you face when you face the fork in the road of all these different relationships we talked about? You say, all I see is the bad. I could spend all day talking about the bad, but I'm having trouble seeing what good can come out of this relationship. How do I see God working good into this situation? And perhaps the answer is in studying the first part of Ephesians 4. I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. Starting at verse 2, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults. Not to say that everything they do wrong is okay, but what kind of patience are you showing, knowing that we also are not perfect? Make allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. Chalmer and Faye Dilling were people Rhonda knew from her church, who would bring roses to church every Sunday. And after the service, they would take a rose from the bunch that they brought and give it to random people. We don't know about the relationship between them, but I'm sure once in a while they gave a rose to somebody that maybe they didn't have a great relationship with or something, or maybe they had a rocky moment that week. And they would give that rose and they would say, you know, I see Jesus in your eyes today. Indeed, perhaps when people drive us to our limits, we want to climb to the highest roof-like structure we can find to get away. But did you know when Jesus encountered people who drove him crazy, like some neighbors, misused their authority like the religious leaders, mistreated the struggling, like even his own disciples sometimes, when people became his enemies, like the Pharisees and Sadducees and his soldiers, and were unfaithful family members like the prostitute he encountered. Did you know that when Jesus encountered those people. He also climbed upon a structure. Except for him, it wasn't a roof, and it wasn't to get away. But instead, he climbed upon the cross to draw himself even closer, becoming the ultimate model of what Paul said right here in Ephesians 4. If you remember those words, Jesus was humble by being the God who came from heaven to be among us, to save and serve. He was gentle in how he related to others. He was patient in people's faults all the way to forgiveness. And as he hung on that cross, gazing out to the many people, those in Jerusalem and even those in other time and space, like you and me today, every single one of us stained in our relationship with God because of our sin. His death brought the unity Paul calls for, not division. Now, that doesn't mean that we go to the cross. It wouldn't do any good. That's already been done. And it doesn't mean that the struggles you face are invalid and are unreal. But as far as it depends on you, can you pray? Can you love? And can you look at each of those people through the eyes of Jesus? Seeing what he sees. Can you truly see Jesus in their eyes? Not because they're perfect and they're acting like Jesus, but because they are loved by Jesus just like Jesus loves you. And he wants them to be with him just as much as he wants you. No, it may not fix your relationship. Unfortunately, I can't offer that solution. But it will be a step toward the peace you can receive, knowing that you are obedient to Christ and you planted a seed or you planted a hot coal that perhaps will set a model for others to follow, perhaps will maybe fix a relationship down the road. And so somewhere along the way, people will be blessed. And so will you as you finally hear those sweet words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us scriptures like this to at least help. One of the greatest regrets we have as pastors is that we can't fix every problem that's out there because we know how those problems tear at the hearts of our people. But Lord, you give us the scriptures to use, to share, so that hopefully we can be encouraged. Hopefully we can have some tools that we can use to maybe learn how to see people through your eyes with love and forgiveness, even if the relationships are never repaired, that we can pray for people and wish for their well-being. Lord, help us in the real, very real situations we face today, whatever those may be. Help us to do just that. Give us the strength to do so. Give us the people to support us who may be going through the same thing. Lord, be with us in those difficult situations. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We'll turn to page 145 in your brethren hymnal. There's a wideness in God's mercy, and I encourage you to focus on verses 3 and 4 and 5, as that brings such meaning to what Pastor Eric shared with us. And as he said, Chalmer and Faye Dilling were people in my church that I grew up with, and they were deacons in our church for as long as I could remember. And I remember the day they would come up to me with one of their roses that they brought every Sunday, and they'd look you in the eye and say, "I see Jesus in you today." And as a 12-year-old, you know, kid, that really spoke to me and gave me hope in myself of what they saw in me. And so think about that legacy that they left with me and many others. And Chalmer, my cousin Courtney and I got to go be with him as he was passing in his 90s. He lived a good long life. And on his deathbed, we saw him in the nursery, in the nursing home he was in. And what stuck with me about his love for God was even on his deathbed, and he was very frail, very skinny, could barely function, he looked at both of us and said, "Tell me about David. Talk to me about David's story," as he could barely breathe. He wanted to know more and hear the words of God, even as he clung to the end. And think about that for your legacy and the ones here and who you look in the eye each Sunday. What do you say to them? Do you speak words of truth and life and tell them, "I see Jesus in your eyes"? Is that what you plant each Sunday or each day? So thankful for that legacy and the legacy that God helps us to create. So please stand and sing, "There's a Wideness in God's Mercy."
Father, be with us now as we leave this place and put your words into practice, letting each person that we encounter, those who are friends or those who are difficult to face, be one more opportunity to see Jesus and to give his love to somebody else. We ask these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.